Workers in Berks is supported by Southeastern PA Area Labor Federation.
Greetings and welcome to the February 2022 Workers in Berks Show. Joe and I are here to welcome you to Black History Month and Labor in Berks. And Joe, you know, what do you got for me here? We got a few announcements and then we got a video. So
We do. We have a terrific lineup of things coming up. And one of the big events that the United Labor Council of Reading and Berks County is engaged in the last few years and for many years really is a spring get together, and the last few years it's been at the Reading Philly Stadium.
Yes.
And it's, so it's on Saturday, May 7th at 5 p.m. I believe.
Yes, 5 p.m.
And it's a great night. Last year was very successful in the midst of the pandemic to bring people together in a safe way and be outdoors together and
yes.
enjoy the premium seating,
yes.
even though there's no game going on.
Right,
the
right.
buffet and the, you know, the drinks and everything else, and mostly the companionship. It's a great time. That's also the time that we have a scholarship contest that we like to encourage people who are from labor families to sign up for.
Yes, yes. And Joe, if I'm not mistaken, someone in your family was fortunate enough to be awarded one. Back in the day.
I do have my youngest daughter won it 1 year, the first year they put it together. She
wow.
was a political science major at Penn State. And now
beautiful.
She's studying to be a labor lawyer, and that's her plan right now.
Wow.
At Villanova. She's in her first year of law school. So
wow, that's great.
And you know, these scholarships, and all three of my children did apply for different AFSCME scholarships, the union mm-hmm. we come from, and
right.
other labor scholarships, and have one, you know, sometimes we scratch our heads and we try to get members to apply because we don't get as many applications as we like
right.
for many of these. So,
right.
so you know, these are all successful. I think every labor union has just about has some kind of scholarship program within itself. This is open to anyone
mm-hmm.
within Berks County Labor Council. So, you know, almost all the labor unions would be
Eligible. Right.
To apply.
Right. Now, I know the flyers, the print's kind of small here, but there's two different ones, both $500, and one is for a graduating senior, and the other one is who is currently in college or trade school. So
yes.
$500 for each of those scholarships, open labor families. Please take advantage of it.
Yeah.
And
And it's interesting you said trade school because it could be any postgraduate work.
Right.
You get out of high school and you're
right. Plumber, doesn't have electrician.
To be, exactly. It doesn't have to be what we think of as college or
that's right.
whatever. So
that's
please
right.
Sign up and we'll put a number out there for people too.
Yes. And if we could put the Reading Berks United Labor Council number up there, please. You know, we'll do this now so that if those folks... Yeah, thank you so much.
There you go.
If those folks are interested, they call that number, leave a message, someone will get back to you.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we have part-time staff there, so 610-374-2725. So thank you very much.
There's another good reason to call that number.
Yes, please tell us.
Mike, we talked with Bob Hoffmaster about this, the president of Labor Council, and you know, one of the things that are going on right now in this pandemic and, you know, 2 years into it, is there's a lot of jobs available. When you drive
right, you
down
are.
The highway, you see signs, you know, going to stores, there seems to be a help wanted sign in every store. Some of them seem to be paying a premium, but one thing that folks should be remembering is labor unions
right.
represented various employers, representing various employers, need help too. And there's a lot of union jobs that are available right now. And many times they don't just come with decent pay, and they also come with benefits and
right.
with health care and with a plan and a career in front of you and,
right.
and a pension, some kind of retirement security.
Yes.
So we'd like people, if they are looking for a union job, to give us a call. And someone, again, will get back to you, maybe talk about what areas you're looking for, what part of the county or what profession, and what your thoughts are, and we'll try to place you with a union job that you might like to take advantage of and learn something from.
Yes, very good. Thanks for mentioning that, Joe, because there are jobs available, and as you say, a living wage, paid time off, pension, you know, security, career. So great opportunities for folks. We need to shout it from the rooftops that they're available.
Absolutely.
So, you know, the union appreciation, you know, Joe, when I look at the small print here, it looks like you're being honored also at that picnic. So kudos to Joe for your many years of dedicated service with the labor movement.
I better start selling some tickets.
That's right.
I didn't even realize it until you said this. This is the first I saw
this.
Well,
good. Well,
and no one gave me a call to say that, so I'd already planned on being there.
Good, good. Yes, we hope that you are there.
I hope
a well-deserved.
I don't know, but thank you.
Reward. Well-deserved.
Wonderful.
Okay, so, you know, Black History Month, labor, ask me. So why did we decide on this, Joe? Why don't you give us a little preview before we go to the video?
We're certainly talking about how do unions affect our lives? And February, as everyone knows, is Black History Month. And what we're going to learn today is the great tie that AFSCME had with Martin Luther King. And Martin Luther King didn't just want people to be free from racial bigotry. He knew that by enhancing people's life, by their work, the dignity of their work, he connected that with the civil rights movement. And it was so evident all through the end of his days.
Yes.
Because,
yes.
As we know, he was leading an AFSCME march trying to form a union in Memphis when the weekend he was assassinated.
Yes.
That's what he was there doing. So we have a great tie with that.
Yes, we do. And, you know, the only American that there is a federal holiday for.
Yep.
And
exactly.
Last month, January, the 93rd birthday of Reverend Martin Luther King. Though he was taken from us far too soon, his words and example continued to reverberate more than a half a century after his assassination.
Mm-hmm.
This comes from the Reading Eagle, a quote from Martin Luther King, "Darkness cannot drive out darkness. Only light can do that. Hate cannot drive out hate. Only love can do that."
Mm-hmm.
And with that, we'd like to watch a video here with the connection with Dr. Martin Luther King and AFSCME.
In 1967, Dr. King organized the Poor People's Campaign, a critical moral step in the struggle for equality. While discrimination and voting rights have always been critical issues for the Black community, he moved people to see that economic justice and racial justice go hand in hand. The Poor People's Campaign was a nonviolent protest by economically struggling Americans of all races. They demanded the basic right to a decent life with dignity. On February 12, 1968, in response to the deaths of Memphis sanitation workers Echo Cole and Robert Walker, AFSCME Local 1733, led by T.O. Jones, called a strike. At the request of strike organizers, Dr. King joined them, uniting the civil rights movement with the labor movement, and the Memphis sanitation strike became a seminal moment in American history.
at the center of the Poor People's Campaign, it wasn't just about poverty where people could not eat or didn't have somewhere to live. It was also poverty that included the working poor. The Memphis Sanitation Workers' Strike was really essential to what the Poor People's Campaign was all about. They would never get fair wages, they would never get benefits, and they would never get opportunities for advancement.
The strike in 1968 in Memphis, Tennessee, with the sanitation workers was a seminal moment within our history, with AFSCME's history, but it also was a seminal moment in American history.
The sanitation workers were not allowed to take a shower when they worked, so they had to walk home in this dirty clothing that was often smelly. The juices of the garbage would fall from holes in the tubs that they carried on their shoulders and dumped into the trucks. For 60 or 80 hours of work a week, they were all men of poverty. They had been trying to organize a union for some 6 years so they could together wage a struggle for workplace safety, pensions, and better wages. These black men doing the storm either had to work in the rain or received no pay that day. Two men took cover in the back of one of the garbage trucks. There was a malfunction, and so they were killed in the mechanism for compressing the garbage.
1,300 African-American workers deciding that they were going to go on strike because not only did they want better pay and wages, but they wanted dignity and respect.
A fellow by the name of Malcolm Blackburn and myself were tasked with finding a slogan, finding the glue that would hold all of this together. And we collectively came up with the term, I am a man.
I am a man. That was a simple slogan that meant so much. They stood up and they said, we are all men. And we aren't going to take it anymore.
On February 23rd, 1968, we thought we had the strike settled. Instead, as we moved down Main Street in a peaceful fashion, we were all maced.
This movement has got to insist that no matter what white citizens or some white citizens might say, we know what police brutality and harassment means, and we are through with it, and we want to see it end once and for all.
This was the first time in the nation that mace had been used for crowd control, and it was a test proposition. If you saw, the officers had their gas masks on, and there was nothing going on with the marchers that required any kind of police control.
We immediately invited Roy Wilkins, president of the NAACP, Byard Rustin of the A. Philip Randolph Institute, and Martin Luther King Jr.
Dr. King was planning the Poor People's March, and he had noticed what was going on in Memphis.
The Memphis Sanitation Workers' Strike really was a perfect case study in many ways for the kinds of change that King wanted to affect with the Poor People's Campaign.
Dr. King clearly understood the incredible contradictions between workers who worked every day yet could not raise themselves out of poverty, nor did they have a process by which they could have a voice in any issues that directly affected their work life.
This is a nonviolent protest.
Dr. King, who had led the Montgomery bus boycott, an internationally known champion for civil and human rights, also emerged as a voice for economic justice.
The issue is injustice. The issue is the refusal of Memphis to be fair and honest in its dealings with its public servants who happen to be sanitation workers.
The first night that Dr. Martin King spoke in March, we had standing room only, probably 10 or 15,000 people. But then we had another 10,000 people in the parking lot. And we had to put up speakers.
Now we're going to march again, and we've got to march again. in order to put the issue where it is supposed to be.
You had heroes like A. Philip Randolph, like Bill Lucic, like so many others who understood the value of connecting the struggle and understood the fact that civil rights and human rights, all those things were connected.
We have an opportunity to make America a better nation. We've got some difficult days ahead, but it really doesn't matter with me now because I've been to the mountaintop. I don't mind. Like anybody, I would like to live a long life. Longevity has its place. But I'm not concerned about that now. I just want to do God's will. And He's allowed me to go up to the mountain. And I've looked over. And I've seen the promised land. I may not get there with you, but I want you to know tonight that we as a people will get to the promised land.
With his death, people stood up and said, we cannot be silent. We can't be silent.
Well, to the labor movement, it was obviously a national tragedy. To Memphis itself, Dr. King had given hope to the workforce.
The city of Memphis recognizes the American Federation of State, County, and Municipal Employees, AFL-CIO, Local 1733, as the designated representative for certain employees in the Division of Public Works.
One of the reasons he came to Memphis was he incorporated the strike as a part of the Poor People's Campaign. With his death, we were greatly set back in the work of that campaign, but the Poor People's Campaign nevertheless went forward, and it did become a symbol and sign of the nonviolent struggle for economic, political, social justice in the United States.
This wasn't just a vision for him, by him. This was a vision for America that they all had to move forward on.
We need to draw comparisons, I believe, with what happened then and what is happening right now. We need to have the courage and the will to do the same kinds of things that those sanitation workers did.
Today, we have a number of organizations that can really focus on very specific issues. It makes it more realistic that we can make the kind of change that's necessary.
The 21st century must produce more nonviolent campaigns, strikes, boycotts, picket lines, civil disobedience than the 20th century ever had. Economic justice, justice for working families.
We always need people to advocate for poor people.
There is a greater gap between the rich and poor than there has ever been in the history of this country. So we must organize like never before. And we must demand that unions are accountable to serve the needs not only of their members, but to serve the needs of the U.S. multiracial working class.
My hope for the labor movement in the future is that the collective leadership look at their role in society, and that is to be a vehicle to improve the quality of life for all workers.
We can win when we fight. And we do what's right. And we organize and mobilize and educate every single day.
When people get caught up with that which is right and they are willing to sacrifice for it, there is no stopping point short of victory.
Wow. I mean, amazing, amazing. You know, a lot of emotions for me, because in 1968, I got to date myself, I was 13. So I was, that was very much contemporary for me. And I worked in the city of Reading, ASME 2763 for 30 years. I've been retired as a retired member of ASME for 10 years. So I'm living, breathing proof. ASME has living wages, good benefits, and I'm living my retirement in dignity. So it's very powerful for me. And I just wanted to share that with our audience. And I know, Joe, that you have some words, and you have some other labor leaders that you want to show before the end of the show here.
Yeah, it is so inspiring. And I'm about 10 years younger than you, Mike. And I don't have the specific memories you would have of 1968, but grew up in a family that appreciated the contributions of John Kennedy, Martin Luther King, and then Robert Kennedy,
yes.
Who were all assassinated. Robert Kennedy assassinated that same year. And I have vague memories of my mother's great sadness mm-hmm. over that period of our country's history and just the how unsettling it was mm-hmm. to see these things happen. But we do have, you know, Martin Luther King had some, we think of him so much and deservedly so, but there are so many black leaders in labor history that we don't, they're not on the tip of our tongue. Mm-hmm. They're not someone that we necessarily know about as much. And I thought, you know, let's highlight a few others and people can Google and
yes.
learn things and dig into some more. But there's a few that we thought we'd talk about just to you know, share. They're all actually contemporaries of the time of Martin Luther King.
Beautiful.
But the first one we'll talk about is Diane Woodard. And Diane grew up in Michigan. She was the from a UAW household. Her dad was an auto worker, and she became a public school teacher. Mm-hmm. And then she became an administrator, first a guidance counselor, then an assistant principal. She went on to become very involved in her union in the early 1990s, so we're not talking that long ago.
Right.
And
wow.
she became, her union was the Organization of School Administrators and Supervisors, where she became the local, you know, vice president, then president, was put on some boards, and in 2009 she was elected national president of that union until her death in 2018.
Wow.
So she was taken early, but she served as on the executive council of the AFL-CIO, and she was credited with bringing unions together to help pass the Every Student Succeeds Act of 2015.
Wow, beautiful, thank you.
We saw in that video one of the principals who was providing some of the quotes, and who's actually, he deflected some of the credit. I'm talking about William Lucy.
Oh.
William Lucy was credited by everybody else as coming up with the slogan, "I am a man."
Uh-huh.
And most of the others, but when he was asked that, he seemed to defer and said it was a group decision.
But I see.
Everything else I read said he came up with it.
Okay.
He was born in 1933. In the 1950s, he was a county employee, was in the engineering department, mm-hmm. an engineer for his county in California. And he incredibly, and AFSCME is a very large union, but from 1972 to 2010, he served as the secretary treasurer of our union, of
wow.
AFSCME. And you know, you just take a step back and you think, wow, that's almost a 40-year time period. That's actually the number two position of this monstrous union. And when he started, there was 200,000 members, and when he left, there was 1.4 million members.
Wow.
So he saw tremendous growth and tremendous organizing
okay.
in that period. Co-founder of the Coalition of Black Trade Unionists, and worked very hard. He started the Free South Africa movement here in this country,
mm-hmm.
and was on the monitoring delegation when Nelson Mandela was first elected
wow.
president of South Africa. And the third individual we're talking about today, Addie Wyatt, lived from 1924 to 2012. Addie was in the early 1940s. She was hired in Chicago by the Armor Company,
wow.
which was meatpacking.
Right.
And she went and applied as a secretary. And when she got there, she said, well, you can't work as a separate secretary. We don't hire any African Americans for those jobs,
mm-hmm.
but you can take a job in the plant. So she did. And she found that union job with a contract actually paid her more in 3 days of work than the secretarial job would have paid her in five.
Wow.
Without the kind of discrimination. So she used that union contract, which was not allowed to use discrimination in the workplace, to conduct a lot of fights to make things better for her coworkers. She eventually the merger of her union with merged into the United Food and Commercial Workers Union in 1979, and she became the first woman international vice president of that union. She was very well known. She's one of the co-founders, one of the founders of the Coalition of Labor Union Women, and a founding member of the Coalition of Black Trade Unionists, and literally made Time Magazine's Woman of the Year. A number of women were honored in 1975, and she was one of them. So
outstanding,
tremendous contributions from her and from the others.
Well, Joe, I want to thank you profusely for your leadership and the homework that you've done here. Now we're on to here. So, any closing remarks here, Joe?
I hope we make sure we all honor the contribution of all the parts of our society, particularly this month, Black History Month. Mm-hmm. And we see that how much better we do together.
Yes.
What are your thoughts, Mike?
Absolutely. Diversity is key. I mean, if everyone at the table looks alike, you're going to get the same results. So diversity is key.
Yep.
And in closing, I'd just like to put up the phone number once again for the United Labor Council. There's union jobs available.
Yep.
Please call us.
Make a phone call.
We have. May 7th, Saturday, $45, 5 p.m. This will be at the Reading Phillies. This will be at the pool area. There's no game, but we'll be there honoring labor leaders, including Joe here, and some other people too also. But absolutely, I was very, very pleased with this program, Joe, and I look forward to working with you in more programs, and I believe we ran out of time, so I want to wish everyone the very best. Support Berks Community Television. That's how we can put these programs on. Want to thank not only the Berks Labor Council, but the Southeast ALF, who sponsor this program, and hope everyone has a safe February. Good night.
Good night.
Workers in Berks is supported by Southeastern PA Area Labor Federation.